Thank you very much for the invitation to this conference and for your attention to the Western Balkans as a whole. Ever since the Yugoslavia war, this region and its citizens are struggling in building democratic states with the right checks and balances and the rule of law, freedom of media and fundamental rights, and to be free from corruption. The citizens of the Western Balkans long for it and deserve it, but they need strong support to realize it. Some of the countries still suffer from ethnic divisions like Bosnia-Herzegovina and Serbia. In others, the level of corruption is high. Yet most citizens don't want to live in segregated areas. They don't want their ethnic background to be decisive for their rights. They lived together peacefully before the war, but ethno-nationalistic rhetoric and policies make it very difficult to achieve that again. The Western Balkans are European countries, surrounded by EU member states. And this gap in the territory of the Union is not good for us, but above all, damaging for the citizens of the Western Balkans. A credible perspective to belong to the European Union would be the strongest incentive to start and complete sustainable reforms, to adopt and realize the European rights and values, and to strongly cooperate with the European Union on vital areas such as climate policies and foreign affairs. And with the Russian aggression, we see how important the latter is, as the Kremlin regime still finds support in the Western Balkans, which is undermining the unity that we need to have in order to isolate Putin. However, this credible perspective is lacking. North Macedonia and Albania are in the waiting room for over 10 years. And although they meet all the criteria, the Union still refuses to open up the negotiation talks. In a video message a few years ago, President Macron promised the citizens of North Macedonia to approve the start of this process if they would be ready to change the name of their country. Can you imagine what a huge effort this is? For instance, changing France into North France, and how powerful his message worked for citizens to sacrifice their country name. Yet afterwards, it was France blocking the start of the negotiation talks. And now Bulgaria imposes unfeasible demands on the government of North Macedonia. And the disappointment is huge. A stable 70% still strongly supports EU accession, but the trust in the EU has sharply decreased. 3 years ago, 43% of the North Macedonian citizens saw the EU as their biggest ally. However, last year, it was only 13%. And the impression that citizens have that the EU has the biggest influence in their country fell down from 45 to 9%. Governments in North Macedonia stepped down because they promised accession talks. And newly elected politicians are mainly driven to undo reforms, to divide the country along ethnic lines and to strengthen ties with Russia and China. So the more distance we keep, the more unfaithful we are, the more alienation from us, which leads to less prospect of European integration for the citizens of the Western Balkans. And these disappointments have an impact on the whole region. In Bosnia-Herzegovina, the leader of the Republika Srpska, Mr. Dodik, is openly glorifying war criminals like Mladic and Karadzic, and seriously threatened to withdraw from the state Bosnia-Herzegovina. Bosnian citizens revive their traumas from the war and are really afraid for new ethnic cleansing. The EU does not only refrain from offering perspective, it also plays an undermining role. For instance, by negotiating with leaders like Dodik, who have a destructive agenda and no interest in European integration at all. Mr. Orban supports him. Croatia demands undemocratic reforms in Bosnia-Herzegovina in order to safeguard one-third of the political representation of the 15% Bosnian population with a Croatian background. Whose interests are we serving? Not those of citizens who want to live peacefully in a democratic society, where they can exercise their rights and have economic prospects for them and their children. Currently, many people are fleeing the countries, in particular young people. They don't see a future for themselves in the Western Balkans. And while the EU is absent or supportive of undermining policies, Russia, China and Turkey are filling this gap. They invest money, but for their own interest. They contribute to rule of law backsliding, destabilization, ethnic division, economic regression, and a lot of environmental damage. This obviously affects their societies, but also this regional instability and Russian influence is an essential threat to us as well. It is high time to pick the right priorities and the right strategy. The Western Balkans need more sustainable and active support for democratic, economic and green reforms. They belong to us, and we have a huge responsibility to make them part of us. We have concrete benchmarks for the integration process, and that should be leading. Nothing else. No internal, electoral or other internal political interests. We must be credible, give them a real impetus for reforms in order to integrate with the European Union. But although we should be aware of this mutual interest, the opposite is happening now. After a hasty political declaration of the President of the Commission von der Leyen that Ukraine should receive the candidate status, which some Western Balkan countries are asking now for decades, the debate has changed. President Macron now proposes to create a kind of political union with neighboring countries, intensive cooperation, but no member statesmanship for the EU. And it seems that he includes also the Western Balkan countries to be part of this union, but not part of the EU. And with this, he seems to give up on the accession of these countries to the EU. And you can imagine that this whole debate, which is pretty abstract, without any clarification on the implications of it, even creates more unrest and distrust with Western Balkan citizens in the EU. So I think we are at a crossroads. Either we clearly and seriously engage with the Western Balkans in a much more proactive way, and we support them in the process of accession, or we admit clearly that they should not count on the EU. I fiercely hope and fight for the first option. Their citizens are Europeans too, and they deserve to enjoy the same rights and values as we take for granted in our own life. Thank you very much for your attention, and have a good conference.